Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, and by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated. Additional support is provided by the Mobil Corporation, Essex Chemical, the American General Corporation, and the Friends of Firing Line.
Michael Kinsley, editor of the New Republic. Welcome to Firing Line. In the famous 1964 case of New York Times against Sullivan, the Supreme Court ruled for the first time that the First Amendment forbids certain kinds of libel suits. In a now legendary phrase, the court held that a public figure suing for libel must prove reckless disregard for the truth. 19 years later, Hustler magazine published an article alleging that Jerry Falwell had had drunken sex with his mother in an outhouse. Falwell sued, not surprisingly, and many thought that the newly Reaganized Supreme Court would use this gruesome opportunity to backtrack on its protection of against libel suits. But the court did just the opposite. In a unanimous decision written by Chief Justice Rehnquist himself, the court held two things. First, it said, it's not reckless disregard for the truth if what you publish is obviously false and clearly not intended to be taken as true. And second, it held that victims of vicious satire cannot avoid the restrictions on libel suits by suing instead for the intentional infliction of emotional distress. Cartoonists and satirists hailed this decision as their Bill of Rights. Jerry Falwell, on the other hand, called it a green light for sleaze merchants. Jerry Falwell is, of course, the founder of the Moral Majority, now called the Liberty Foundation, and the prominent television evangelist. He's coming to us today from his own studio in Lynchburg, Virginia. Harriet Pilpel needs no introduction to the Firing Line audience. She's a lawyer, an inveterate battler in liberal and feminist causes, and she is brought in whenever William Buckley needs someone to eloquently defend a cause that he feels is indefensible. Now, Mr. Buckley, surely if the government could forbid the intentional infliction of emotional distress by journalists, this would not only deny people like you and me our ability to make a living, it would deny us much of our pleasure in life, don't you think?
Well, to what extent our pleasure in life ought to be superordinated over the Constitution is interesting. It's generally accepted that the Constitution limits our freedom to the extent that other people's freedoms conjoin our own. The old cliche is, "I'm free to do anything with my arm up until the moment that I hit your chin."
Right.
Now, what fascinates me about this case is that clearly you had rumblings in America that have been dissatisfied with the Sullivan ruling. The Sullivan ruling made it all but impossible for a public figure to sue. The neat little legal maneuver done by Mr. Falwell's lawyers was to say, okay, We grant that they knew it wasn't true, didn't attempt to prove that it was true, but in the course of proceeding with that caricature, they caused emotional distress. Now, Mr. Falwell, tell us briefly what the history was of your proceeding before it got to the Supreme Court, because the narrative is extremely interesting.
Well, Bill, first of all, through the years prior to our filing suit against Mr. Flint and Hustler magazine, he had constantly caricatured us, and we understand that. That's part of being a public figure, the cartoons, the foolishness, and even things that I wouldn't discuss publicly and on television. Never bothered us at all until this particular full-page ad, which he called a parody, in the which he depicted me as an incestuous drunkard who had had sexual relations with my 82-year-old mother in an outhouse, and then the kind of language and ascribed to my mother, who happened to be a very wonderful and godly lady, long since in heaven, I determined that there must be limits to everything. I am a publisher of a magazine. I'm a publisher of a newspaper, going to hundreds of thousands of homes. I am a public speaker on television, radio, on a daily basis. So very much aware of and sensitive to First Amendment rights. I don't think anybody needs them more than I do, defending the causes that often you and I are the only one agreeing on.
Well, now, what happened in when you filed suit? Tell us what happened, because some people don't remember.
Well, we filed suit against Mr. Flint for a number of things. Roy Grutman, who I think is probably the leading First Amendment attorney in the country, positioned there in New York City.
Whom I taught Spanish at Yale.
Yeah, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
And Roy represented me. He filed suit on a number of premises, but advised me from the beginning that very likely the only hope we have, since proving malice, which is necessary for libel, is almost impossible. The only likelihood would be the one that we did get, and that is the intent to inflict emotional anguish. Public figure, there were some who feel that a public figure is open game for anything and everything and would therefore have no civil rights at all. We contended that a public figure is still a human being and that there are limits, such as yelling fire in a crowded theater, or as you said earlier, where your fist touches my chin. Yeah. Civil rights end. So we thought that...
Tell us what happened, because we're going to discuss all these...
We went to the Western District Court in here in Roanoke, Virginia. A jury, in fact, found in our favor on that one item, did not on libel. It was then, of course, appealed by Mr. Flint to the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals in Richmond, Virginia. The full court ruled in our favor. It then went to the Supreme Court, where we lost unanimously. And we were fully aware that it was a gamble all the way. And when you're talking First Amendment, you're talking matters of the greatest sensitivity. But we're glad we tried. We're sorry we lost.
Let me recapitulate before we ask Ms. Pilpel to comment. The jury said Mr. Falwell has not been libeled, presumably because nobody believes this.
Yes.
Under the circumstances, since nobody believes it, you didn't suffer any pecuniary loss or loss of congregation or whatever. But you did suffer emotionally from the embarrassment and humiliation of something being said that was knowingly false. Now, am I correct, Ms. Pilpel, that this is the first time that this so-called intentional attempt to cause mental distress was used as an avenue to get around the Sullivan Doctrine comprehensively?
Well, the court itself said that there had been a number of efforts to use the doctrine of infliction of emotional distress to get around the libel and privacy claims. Now, Dr. Falwell did in fact sue for a violation of his right of privacy, for libel, and for causing emotional distress. Both on the ad and in the table of contents, it was indicated that this was fictional, so that nobody, even if they would otherwise have believed it, could possibly have believed it, because it was listed as fiction in the table of contents, and it was there was a little legend on the picture itself saying that it was fictional. Actually, I agree with Dr. Falwell on one point, and that is he said he's glad he brought the case. I don't know why he's glad he brought the case, but I know why I'm glad that he brought the case, because as both of you, I think, indicated, there have been sort of mutterings from some Supreme Court justices that New York Times against Sullivan, the thing that makes it so difficult for public figures or officials to sue for libel, was maybe not such good law anymore. And we now have a decision which says that New York Times against Sullivan is just as alive as it ever was, if not more so. Also, there have been some doubts as to some of the justices with reference to what they really feel about the First Amendment. And there have been some decisions that have caused people since the Warren Court to be a little bit afraid of what might come next. We now find that what came next was the most complete vindication of First Amendment freedoms that most of us have ever encountered.
Well, we've got to watch it, I think, here, because Hugo Black, for instance, would think that the most complete vindication of First Amendment freedoms would be have no libel laws at all.
Yes,
so
but
you might say, well, the best vindication of the First Amendment is to abolish libel laws.
Well, some people do say that.
Well, I know some people do say that. I don't say that. Ms. Falwell doesn't say that. Do you say that?
I have never said that, but neither have I encountered any case which might even question, make me question that, because it is true, as the court at Justice Rehnquist, who has been not at all particularly favorable toward free speech and press, said, in the words of Justice Holmes, that when times come, fighting faiths are going to be fought out. The only solution is to find out which faith triumphs in the marketplace. And while I don't know that Holmes agreed with Douglas and Black that there could be no libel, he certainly agreed that an idea or a presentation would have to be almost unthinkable to prevent it from being aired in the marketplace by a public figure.
Let me attempt a distinction, Ms. Falwell. I think this is an extremely important one. Here's a paragraph from Rehnquist's opinion. He said, there's no doubt that the caricature of respondent, that's you and his mother, published in Hustler, is at best a distant cousin of the political cartoons described above, i.e. the traditional caricatures, and a rather poorer relation at that. If it were possible, by laying down a principled standard to separate the one from the other, public discourse would probably suffer little or no harm, but we doubt that there is any such standard, and we are quite sure that the pejorative description outrageous does not supply one. Now, here it seems to me he's attempting to say somebody who speaks as a politician, or even who speaks as a preacher, can be caricatured in respect of what he is publicly identified for. But if you're, say, a hot Democrat anxious to humiliate Ronald Reagan, you shouldn't be able to depict him as a child molester, since it is a far cry from his Persian Gulf policies to child molesting. Now here, I think Rehnquist is trying to say that. If you can distinguish between the two, it would not harm public discourse. Now I say, it is the job of the intellectuals in America, and above all of the lawyers, to make that distinction, to say about Falwell, look, we don't like you, we don't like your business, we don't like Christianity, we don't like anything that you've done, and we're going to make fun of it. But this does not, in my judgment, entitle them to make fun of it by entirely irrational and perverse depictions of his relations with his mother.
May I answer that?
Sure.
I have, in the
course... In fact, you may not answer that.
I have, in the course of my practice, heard that statement that you made, surely this can be isolated out, made in a number of other ways, which, if anything, are more persuasive than Dr. Falwell's, of course. For example, some organized Jewish groups wanted to get away from The Merchant of Venice and Oliver Twist altogether, because surely that is racial hatred being fomented and so forth. There has been a military...
How is that unrelated? If one is an anti-Semite and one wants to take The Merchant of Venice and stimulate anti-Semitism, one has the raw material there.
And one has the
but
right
I'm talking
to do
about
that.
Something that's unrelated to this. But one couldn't legitimately stimulate a hatred of the Jew in The Merchant of Venice by saying that Shakespeare forgot to record that he was also a child molester, right?
Well, you could say that, but I don't think that that would be any more entertainable as a cause of action than the cause of action that Dr. Falwell asserted.
Why shouldn't it be?
It shouldn't be because what I think is unprintable, unthinkable, is not necessarily unprintable and unthinkable by anyone else.
No, but this is an act of sheer nescience. It's saying that you cannot know that which is knowable. The fact of the matter is that whatever disagreements you have with me, it would be disreputable and, in my judgment, actionable if you were to say that I drowned my infant daughter when she was born. You don't have that right. And nobody has the right to say about Mr. Falwell that he had that kind of relationship with his mother. And to say that has nothing whatever to do with our right to criticize Mr. Falwell in respect of what makes him a public figure.
But you see, the mere fact that you and Mr. Falwell disagree with the United States Supreme Court, where the opinion was written by one of the most, if not the most, conservative members of the court.
He's very unhappy about the opinion.
Well, he wrote it.
No,
he's happy.
He wrote it because people like you have not given him a hand in making the proper distinctions.
I don't believe that Justice Ray has been at all waiting for us to say anything. In fact, often when we say things, I have a feeling they don't reach him.
He says, if it were possible, if it were possible. Now, a lot of people say, well, if it were possible to run a 4-minute mile, and nobody did it until 1950. But why shouldn't people be making that effort instead of taking the slippery slope argument? The slippery slope argument says you can't deny anybody the right to do or say anything. The
not
answer
to
is
do,
you can.
To say.
Yes, sir.
There is a great distinction that I don't think you're making in anything you're saying between doing and saying.
In the first place, there are libel laws. If Mr. Falwell weren't a public figure, he could have won easily because they wouldn't have been protected by the Sullivan Doctrine.
But
so there are, in fact, laws that say you can't simply extemporize remarks which are clearly and validly false at the expense of somebody who's not a public figure. Let's hear from Mr. Falwell on that.
Well, I feel that the Supreme Court is such a sophisticated body, and the ultimate attorneys of all the attorneys, that they had the ability, as did the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals, to draw those lines.
What was the breakdown in the Fourth Circuit?
It was 6-5.
6-5.
Which is
that's
very
still
close.
A majority. That's mm-hmm. still a majority. And Mr. Reagan didn't appoint all those justices, by the way. And I feel that on something of this vital importance, it was justified to give it adequate time to find what those definitive markers were. And because really, there's nothing without limits. Only God is unlimited. We place limits on everything. I do not believe.
No, even God is even God is limited. As St. Thomas Aquinas said, God can't say that 2 and 2 make 5.
Nor can he sin. And
that's right.
So limited in that sense. And so I feel that the legitimate media would not have been affected at all. There would be not one article, not one cartoon, not one bit of buffoonery. Nothing limited in the legitimate field. Only the Flints and that ilk of sleaze merchants would have been affected. And the tragedy is we are so sensitive about First Amendment, and I am one of those sensitive persons, that we take our sensitivity to a fault.
Well, now, Ms. Pilpel, how do you handle that? There is obviously brewing in America a dissatisfaction with the existing structure of the laws. There's a brilliant book coming out by Richard Clement on the Sharon trial and on the Westmoreland trial. And here we had a rebuke of the defendants by the court, but no money satisfaction. Actually, General Sharon came back and said that he had been exonerated, in effect. In England, of course, they have the money satisfaction that the loser has to pay the costs of the winner. Are you in favor of that, simply to begin with?
No, I'm not necessarily in favor of that if it brought in the opposite, namely that the loser could be the plaintiff, because if, as is very often the case, the plaintiff is not like Dr. Falwell, a person of great eminence and wealth, but is instead a poor person who has been badly treated in some way and lost his job, if he were required to pay the counsel fees, he couldn't bring the action. And I don't believe that anybody should be disenfranchised from suing. But when you come to libel,
that's the oddest remark I've ever heard, because most people in the world are disenfranchised from suing.
You mean because they don't have that much money?
They don't have that much money.
But in England, I think the situation is that the courts are not so great, and I don't think it has worked out as badly as I know it would here.
Why?
Because I think that libel is not as popular a pastime in England as it is here, because...
But on the contrary, it's much more popular. However, it's much more expeditious. You can file on Monday and have a judgment 3 weeks from now, and after a 2-day trial, not our kind of 4 years.
Well, therefore, it isn't anywhere near that expensive. But
no.
I would like to point out again, with reference to Dr. Falwell's statement, he doesn't think, quote, sleaze merchants should have a right to be sleazy, in quotes, and that it would
no.
be easy.
No, I never said that, Harriet. I think while nothing would bring greater pleasure to me than to see these gentlemen go out of business. At the same time, I do not think they should be legally put out of business. I think this is a free enterprise, marketplace decision. in the last 8 years, for example, that 25,000 retail stores that no longer sell Penthouse, Hustler, Playboy, and we've had a little part in doing that. That is free marketplace restriction, but I do not think that judicially or legislatively we should deny them the right to print or write their garbage. However, I think that they should have limitations, and I felt so strongly that I took action.
Well, the limitations, if I may say so, should at the very least be able to recognize harm being done. I'd like to make two distinctions, which I don't think have been adequately recognized. One is that the libel laws, whether about a private or a public person, apply to statements of fact. They do not apply to statements of opinion. Now, you can argue as to which this is, but you have to have a statement of fact. When it comes to public figures, you need, in addition to a factual statement, knowledge on the part of the person who made that statement that the facts were false or that he was reckless in not finding out whether they were true or false.
Well, Harriet, I'll acknowledge that had my 82-year-old mother been left out of the article, the chances are there would have been no action. I will admit to that. As you well know, you cannot sue for a person who is deceased. And therefore, the anguish of hurting my mother was, for me, an imputation to myself. I identified with that, and I rather think, and I don't even know you, Harriet, but I rather think had the
why do you call her Harriet if you don't know her?
Well, I saw her name on the screen there just a moment ago. And she can call me Jerry, and feel free to do
Thank
so.
You.
And I rather think had the ad been of Harriet and her mother or father, I rather think that she might be sitting where I'm sitting today rather than there defending the issue.
No, actually she wouldn't, because Harriet is a very principled woman, and she would, I think incorrectly, feel that this was a sacrifice necessary to sustain the vitality of the First Amendment. My point, which I think is a little bit closer to your own, is that the First Amendment doesn't gain in vitality, but loses in vitality if we simply assume that it is a guarantor against any kind of speech. In the absence of rules of any kind,
like
a conversation
this,
becomes anarchic.
Yes, I liken this sometimes to Presbyterian theology, to which I hold, and that is Calvinism, the sovereignty of God and his dealings, and that he chooses and selects through a foreordination and election to salvation. To believe that, and to believe also in the perseverance of the saints, that once a member of the family of God, always a member of the family of God, is a license to go out and do wrong because you're guaranteed heaven, is a perversion of the doctrine and demeans the doctrine, just as allowing Mr. Flint and others to do what they do is a perversion of the First Amendment.
I would like to answer that by saying that I don't purport or pretend to be an authority on the theology part of it, so I won't comment on that. With reference to the non-theological part of it, I would like to say that I have heard many groups say, in effect, what Dr. Falwell just said, and say, you can make this speech forbidden. It would only apply to anti-Semites. It would only apply to people who preach what an infamy toward women. You're familiar, I'm sure, with a group of women who have gone around saying that there should be a procedure whereby when women in a sexual context are depicted as lower than men, in some way deprived of...
she was on this program, yeah.
Oh, Andrea Dworkin,
yeah.
Yes. She's one of them. Well, she's another one who's a real free speaker, except when it comes to what really seems to her objectionable. The greatness of our country, I think above almost any country in the world, is that we are a very diverse people. We have people with diverse ideas, diverse originations, and so forth. And yet the fact remains that because we have freedom of speech and of the press, democracy works. As you know, our Constitution is the oldest one still in effect. It guaranteed freedom of speech in the press. There is reason to believe that Black and Douglas may have been correct when they said that Congress and the state shall make no abridgment, that they meant no abridgment. Now, Mr.
And then when they say the executive authority rests in the president, they cannot be a special prosecutor.
Well, that, I have no idea about the special prosecutor because
I'm saying that all these have been qualified over the years, and as recently as 7-1 on the matter of the right of the special prosecutor exists, notwithstanding the Article 2 gives the president the only power.
Yeah, but I'm on your side on literalness. I'm saying that the First Amendment says Congress shall make no law abridging freedom of speech or of the press, and they said no law.
Mrs. Pilpel, with you and Buckley on the same side, I think we ought to stop right there. Mr. Buckley, this distinction you rather alarmingly think intellectuals ought to be in the business of making between permissible and impermissible forms of insult. I don't really understand it. Do you want to limit this to allegations of fact, as in the Falwell case, or do you want to give intellectuals the right to sort of decide any kind of insult, even with no factual content in it, has simply gone too far?
The point I'm trying to make is that a certain exposure ought to be expected by people who enter public life. If one enters public life, let's say, as an ardent advocate of reform in basketball, to the extent that people want to make fun of that person as a basketball reformer, they ought to be free to do so. The notion that he ought automatically to be exposed because he is loud on the subject of basketball to any infamy of any sort strikes me as intellectually decadent. This is exactly what happened in the Falwell case. His relations with his mother have nothing whatever to do with his public mission. I think that the intellectuals, who after all dominate thought and should dominate thought, ought to be there to show the lawyers how they can reason from reasonable protection under the First Amendment to unreasonable protection, the effect of which really is to, in my judgment, distort the meaning of the First Amendment.
I think it's very important.
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, and by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated. Additional support is provided by the Mobil Corporation, Essex Chemical, the American General Corporation, and the Friends of Firing Line. For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $3 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. Indicate the subject of the program, and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SICA, which is solely responsible for its content.